Maybe by Jean-Baptiste Delis from the University of the Geneva Observatory. He will talk about the spin dynamics in closing planets with transit time variation.
Thank you. So it's a work I've done in collaboration with Alexandre Correa, Adrien Leleu and Philippe Robitaille. And we have a paper that is forthcoming in AMA very soon. So we study the spin dynamics of closing planets, that is planets with orbital periods typically smaller than 20 days. And for those very closing planets, we expect the tidal dissipation to be very strong. So it is usually assumed that those planets synchronize and circularize. So we end up with a planet that is always showing the same face to the star on a circular orbit. This synchronization corresponds to a one-to-one spin orbit resonance, and you can study the dynamics of this resonance by looking at the expression of the tidal torque. So here, theta is the angle of the tidal bulge of the planet. B minus A over C is the deformation of the planets, and F is the true longitude of the planet. So if you have a circular orbit, for instance, the true longitude is equal to the mean longitude, and it's a linear function of time. And if you replace this expression in the equation of the tidal torque, you obtain a simple pendulum-like equation on the simple pendulum phase space. So here you have a fixed point corresponding to the exact resonance, and then you have a libration area, the separatrix of the resonance in red, and outside of the separatrix, the spin evolution is non-resonant. So this is for the circular case, for circular orbits, but now if you have an eccentric orbit, then the true longitude can be extended in the Fourier series of the mean longitude or the time, and when you replay this in the equation of the tidal torque, you obtain this bit more complex equation with many terms. You still have the term corresponding to the one-to-one resonance, but now you have other terms corresponding to k over 2 spin orbit resonances. And for instance, Mercury is in a 3-to-2 spin orbit resonance. And this resonance appears because the eccentricity of Mercury is 0.2. But for closing planets, we expect that tidal dissipation completely dump the eccentricities. So we don't expect to have any k over 2 spin orbit resonance at the end, but only the one-to-one synchronous resonance. So this is why people often assume those closing planets to be synchronized. So here we are studying another kind of spin orbit resonance, which arises when we have some planet-planet interaction, so a multiplanetary system. And so we have a perturbation of the orbit of the planet we are studying. And this perturbation will be maximum when the planet is close to or inside a mean motion resonance. And you can show that at first order, the effect of the mean motion resonance is this one on the mean longitude of the planet. So you have the Keplerian evolution plus the periodic term with amplitude alpha and frequency nu. Nu is the libration frequency if the system is locked in the resonance. And it's the circulation frequency if the system is close to the resonance but outside of it. If you assume small eccentricities, then the true longitude also have the same expression. And when you replace this expression in the torque, the expression of the torque, you obtain this equation, where you still have the term corresponding to the synchronous resonance, but you have also two new terms corresponding to two new resonances, which are very close to the synchronous resonance, but shifted by nu over 2. So there is a sub-synchronous resonance and a super-synchronous resonance. those asynchronous resonances were already found in the case of co-orbitals on circumbinary objects by Alexandre Corella and co-authors. And here is simply another example of these resonances for a perturbation that comes from a mean motion resonance with another planet. But in fact, the mechanism is very general. As long as you have a perturbation in the expression of the mean longitude of the planet of this kind, you will find new spin orbit resonance of this kind. So we basically have three parameters in the model. The first one is sigma, the width of the synchronous resonance, and it depends on the shape of the planet and the deformation of the planet. And the two other parameters come from the planet-planet interactions, the perturbation of the orbits. Alpha is the amplitude of the perturbation and will change the width ratio between the asynchronous resonances and the synchronous one. And nu is the frequency of the perturbation and will change the distance between the resonances. So depending on the value of all those parameters, you can have three well-separated resonances, and the spin can be captured in any of the three resonances. But you can also have an overlap of the resonances, and thus a chaotic evolution of the spin. What is interesting here is that two of the parameters we need to determine can be very precisely determined if you have access to the TTVs of the planets. So the TTVs are the transit timing variations. So if you observe the transit of the planet in front of its star, and if you have this kind of perturbation in the orbit, sometimes the transit will be a bit early, and sometimes the transit will be a bit later. And this is illustrated here. It's real data taken from a paper by Nesvorny. And you see the successive transit of the planet, and you see an oscillation in the transit timing. And if you measure the amplitude of this oscillation and the period of this oscillation, you have a direct measurement of the amplitude and the period of the perturbation, so the parameters alpha and nu that we need to determine. What is also interesting is that you even don't have to completely determine the orbital dynamics of the system. If you are able to measure the TTVs, you have the value of those parameters, and you almost don't care about the orbit of the perturber. Okay, the last parameter we need to determine is sigma, the size of the synchronous resonance, and it depends on the shape, on the deformation of the planet. So we have two components in this deformation, the permanent frozen deformation, which we can estimate by looking at the rocky planets in the solar system. And the other component is what Silvio described this morning, the tidally induced deformation of the planet. And in fact, it's due to the tide exerted by the star on the planet. And the instantaneous equilibrium figure of the planet will be always directed toward the star. But how the planet reacts to this instantaneous forcing depends on the relaxation time of the planet, too. So if this relaxation time is very fast, then the deformation of the planet will always follow the equilibrium figure. But if it's longer, then the planet will take time to adapt to this continuously changing equilibrium figure. And what happens is that if you are outside of any spin orbit resonance, the forcing by the star will tend to average out, and you will not have a significant long-term deformation of the planet. But if you are locked in a spin orbit resonance, then the average of the equilibrium figure over an orbit is not negligible. And so after a resonant capture, then the deformation will increase due to this tidally induced deformation. Okay, so let's take some examples. Here is KOI-227b. It's a planet observed by the Kepler telescope, so with the transit method. The orbital period is 18 days. And it's a planet with large TTV. The amplitude of the TTV is 8 degrees. The perturber is not observed, it's not transiting, so we can't determine the orbital properties of this perturber. But using the TTVs, Nesbonic could determine that the system must be inside a mean motion resonance, but it couldn't determine which one. It could be the outer 221, the outer 322, or the inner 322. But as I told earlier, we don't really need to know the exact orbital dynamics because we have access to the value of alpha and nu. So to study the spin of the planet, it's a bit equivalent, all those solutions. So we also determine, estimate the deformation of the planet in using only the permanent frozen deformation and also using the maximum tidally induced deformation of the planet. And, we did some numerical simulations here in the conservative case of the spin dynamics. So here it's with the permanent deformation. We see three islands corresponding to the three spin orbit resonance. So this is the synchronous resonance, the supersynchronous, and the subsynchronous resonances. So in this case, we have three well-separated islands. But if we increase the deformation of the planet, here it's the maximum tidally induced deformation, then we see a very large chaotic area in red, englobing all the three resonances. But we still have an island of stability in the middle of the resonance. We also did some dissipative simulation. So here we start with the spin very fast at the beginning, and it, due to the dissipation, it's slowing down. And it will cross eventually the resonances. And we use different values for the relaxation time of the planet. For very fast relaxation, the spin always ends up in the synchronous resonance. But when we increase the relaxation time, we have some capture in the asynchronous resonances. And in fact, we have even more probability to be captured in the supersynchronous resonance than in the synchronous one for some value of the relaxation time. Here is another example, Kepler 88b. It's a gaseous planet and with an orbital period of about 11 days. And it's called the king of TTVs because it has the largest TTV known today. It's 16 degrees. Again, the perturber is not transiting, it's not observed, but this time Nesbonic could determine a unique orbital solution, and the perturber must be close but outside of the 221 resonance with the observed planet. Again, we estimate the size of the synchronous resonance, the deformation of the planet. Here it's a gaseous planet, so the permanent deformation is negligible, but we still have the tidally induced deformation that can be non-negligible. And we see in this case that using the maximum tidally induced deformation, we have a very large chaotic area with a small island of stability that is remaining. So we also did some dissipative simulation and with different values of the relaxation time. For short relaxation time, we always end in the synchronous resonance. But when we increase the relaxation time, we have some chaotic evolution of the spin in this case. And so the spin evolves in between all the spin orbit resonance close to the synchronous one. So to conclude, it is often assumed that close-in planets synchronize. But we've seen that if you have strong planet-planet interaction, then the spin dynamics can be a bit more complex. And the TTV signal provides very useful information to study the spin evolution with the amplitude of the period of the TTVs being a direct measurement of the amplitude and period of the perturbation on the planet. So obviously, planets with very large TTVs are the most interesting to study for the spin evolution, because in this case, you can have non-synchronous resonances and even chaotic evolution of the spin. Thank you for your attention.
One is, let us start from the end. Which is the kind of dissipation that, because the capture probability depends a lot on the kind of dissipation that you use.
So what it's Maxwell rheology.
So it's a linear in the in theta dot. What is the shape, the analytic shape of the dissipation? Do you remember that?
Like one single control this morning.
Okay,
so there is a regime which is linear, and there's another regime that is not linear.
Okay, so it's a connected. And the second question is, if I understood well, at the beginning you say you take the spin of the problem where you have the orbital radius and the true anomaly, and you insert it as, and you perturb it with another planet, right? Okay, so, I don't understand why you don't find just a synchronous resonance and not the other resonances. Do you have any analytical explanation? Because from the mathematical point of view, I would say that this is, if you take the planet, the perturbing planet to be small enough, then you have a periodic orbit which should survive under perturbation by continuation method or inclusive function theorem. So I would say that the statement strongly depends on the perturbation that you insert.
The fact that there is no k over 2
no resonance except the synchronous one. This is what you wrote in.
No, this statement is in the unperturbed case and with circular orbits.
No, the other slide. No.
Assuming
the eccentricity is small,
small
is zero or different from zero?
Yeah, it's negligible. If the eccentricity is very small, then the size of all those k over 2 resonances will be very small. But in fact, at larger eccentricities, you will have all the k over 2 spin orbit resonances, and you will also have.
Okay, it's the size of eccentricity.
Yeah, yeah, and but what is interesting also is that you will have the k over 2 plus nu over 2 resonances, all those, and you also have other harmonics of all those angles if you.
Yes.
The nu? The nu is the libration frequency in the resonance if you're in the resonance. The libration resonance? No, the orbital, the mean motion resonance.
Okay, exactly. this is a small number, but in addition to that, you can have more small frequencies. So
yes,
but become more constant in that sense. Let's say that the three, let's say the multi-level resonances are separated, but there are more
things that are different. Yeah, but I think that if you want some chaotic evolution or like that, you need to have a separation of the resonance that is comparable with the size of the resonance. And for the secular frequency, I think you will be much smaller than in the size. So you just will have a small chaotic area around the separatrix.
And
I think so, yeah. It all depends on the numbers or on the size of the resonance. Like that, but I think the most interesting cases are when the frequency nu is smaller than the mean motion, but not too small, because it wants it to be comparable with the size of the region. And in this case, it's very comparable, the same order of magnitude.
I may have missed the point. In the last case, you said that the synchronous resonance becomes completely chaotic because it's, we have a strong overlapping regime. But so nevertheless, you can capture in the one-to-one. So how can you capture if the entire resonance is chaotic?
Well, because in this case, it's a gaseous planet, so the permanent deformation is negligible. So if you are outside of the spin orbit resonance, then the deformation is very small, and you can be captured in the synchronous.
Okay.
And then, if you are captured in the synchronous resonance, the deformation starts to increase. And if it increases too much, you have the chaotic area here. But if it's, I didn't show, but if it's, of course, if the deformation is smaller, then you will have separated islands on the bigger.
Okay, so it's not, there's not like the capture case does not refer to this point.
No, no, no.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.